From the Gospel of St. Luke. He then addressed this parable to those who were convinced of their own righteousness and despised everyone else. Two people went up to the temple area to pray. One was a Pharisee, and the other was a tax collector. The Pharisee took up his position and spoke this prayer to himself. O God, I thank you that I am not like the rest of humanity, greedy, dishonest, adulterous, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I pay tithes on my whole income. But the tax collector stood off at a distance and would not even raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast and prayed, O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, the latter went home justified, not the former. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and the one who humbles himself will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and the one who humbles himself will be exalted. And that's the invitation that we receive from the Lord. The one who humbles himself will be exalted. It is through humility that we come closer to our Lord Jesus Christ. And notice what happened in the parable, how this tax collector, who was known as a public sinner, it was his humility. It was not even coming closer to the Lord, to in the temple, that he stayed from a distance, realizing that he was a sinner. That humility helping to realize that he was not worthy of the Lord, that he was a sinner, and he was praying for mercy. But he realized that in praying for mercy, he was going to receive the graces from the Lord. And that's what we do when we come to the celebration of the Holy Eucharist. The very beginning of the celebration of the Holy Mass, we, like the tax collector from today's gospel, we say to the Lord, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison. Lord, have mercy. We realize publicly that we are sinners. And the good thing about a sinner is not that we have sinned. No, we can't sin. We are to live a holy life. But the good thing about realizing that we are sinners is that we know that we cannot do everything on our own. We need the Lord to help us. We can't get out of our sinful life without the graces of our Lord Jesus Christ. Graces that he gives us through the intercession of the saints, through our prayers, through our acts of charity, through our forgiveness, through our cooperation and help with others. The Lord says, the one who humbles himself will be exalted, and will be exalted by Jesus Christ. May the Lord help us to be humble, not to allow our pride to take over and control of our lives, but humility. Humility make our hearts more like the one of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is a way for the Lord to model our lives and our hearts. During the summers, during the Sundays of this summer, we have been talking about how the devil plays different tricks to us to take us away from the Lord. And for example, the opposite of humility, as we see in today's gospel, is the pride. That's why the Lord says, for anyone who exalts himself will be humble. Anyone with the pride of in his own heart will be humbled by the Lord. But the one who humbles himself will be exalted. And humility is a virtue. It's a virtue that comes from the Lord. But the pride comes from the evil one. Pride creates division. Pride creates war. And creates something that is not pleasing in the eyes of the Lord. And we talk about different tricks then coming from the devil during these last Sundays of summer. We talk about temptations as the most common trick from the devil. Temptation is an unhealthy curiosity, and a temptation comes only from the devil. A temptation doesn't come from the Lord, but from the devil. And it is for everyone. You and I are being victims of the devil with the temptation that he presents to us. He presented them also to our Lord Jesus Christ in the desert of Judah before he started his public ministry. Temptations are things that we have to be careful of. Temptations are unhealthy curiosities that are everywhere where we live, in the places where we live, in the places where we work, out on the street. We have to be careful not to get into something that we know is not good for our souls, for our salvation, for our lives. And the second one is a little stronger than that, than the temptations. The second one is the infestation. It's when the devil starts working and makes his presence a little stronger through a place, like a house, a place of work, or through an object. Either the object or the place that had been dedicated to the devil or somehow had been in direct contact with the devil. The infestation comes, the presence of the Lord comes a little stronger. Because the devil is not everywhere. God is everywhere, and God has the power to see what's inside of our heart. The devil doesn't have that power. He wants to have that power, but he doesn't have it. That's why he has to use infestations. He has to, through places and objects dedicated to him or that came into contact somehow through him, he uses it as a way to make his presence stronger. That's the infestation. We also have the vexation. The vexation is when the devil starts attacking a little stronger the surroundings of the person. And he attacks his family and his job and his health. He's trying to create a lot of pressure in the person to the point that the person is going to break down, to say, I'm going to abandon the Lord. I feel that he doesn't help me anymore, and just be despair. That's the purpose of the devil with the vexation. And we saw how a perfect example is the life of Job in the Holy Scripture. He lost his family, he lost his reputation, his job, his health, but he was able at the end to remain faithful to the Lord. That's the vexation. And then the obsession, when the devil starts attacking the person in his mind and is bringing these evil thoughts, especially the ones on kill yourself, you're not worthy, or kill someone else. That's something that comes directly from the devil. And it brings a lot of people to depression and to commit a suicide. That's the obsession. Sometimes obsession could be just psychological, but sometimes it could be just one of the attacks from the devil. Or sometimes it could be an attack from the devil that becomes a psychological problem. So we have to be careful about it. If you know of anyone who thinks that he or she is not worthy of living this beautiful life, be an instrument of God and talk to that person that he or she are beautiful and worthy of the Lord. That Jesus Christ died for that person on the cross. That's how important we are. That we were created in the image and likeness of God. That our problems are nothing compared to the beautiful gift of life that Jesus has given us. That is more important. Our lives are more important than our problems. Every problem has a solution. Sometimes the solution is not a solution. Sometimes it's just we have to move over and leave it behind. But we'd never have to think that a problem is too much, is too heavy, that we cannot handle it. No. The Lord always gives us the graces to overcome it and to realize there is something better waiting for us. And another attack that we receive from the devil is the possession, and that's the strongest one. A possession is when the devil takes control of the body of one person. And notice again that he only takes control of the body, not the soul, but just the body or a part of the body. The devil sometimes manipulates matter, but he hasn't had the power to go and to work on our will. He never has that power. We have the freedom always to choose what is right, to choose what is holy. The devil can't manipulate that part. He can bring a lot of temptations and he can try to bring a lot of confusion into our lives. But at the end, the Lord has given us the power to choose. We have the power to choose, and we are to choose what is right and what is holy. And remember what the Lord says, that before the devil comes without temptation, he has already come with the graces for us to overcome that temptation. So possession is the strongest attack of the devil when he has control of the body of someone. But we know from our experiences how sometimes even the saints can be attacked by the devil, even without possession. There was a lady, for example, in Nazareth, who was a saint, and yet she was possessed by the devil. Because the devil, the relationship that she had with the Lord from her soul was not affected by the possession of the devil in her body. So she was able to remain in this state of grace with the Lord, even though her body was being used by the devil. So that's how powerful the Lord is. We can be close to Him. He gives us the graces to be faithful to Him till the end. And then the last one, and this is the end of our talk about these tricks and these attacks from the devil. And the last one is disturbance. And a disturbance usually happens to the saints. Like, for example, Padre Pio experienced them a lot. Padre Pio, a disturbance is a physical attack from the devil, direct attack from the devil when it comes to the body, like pushing him. Like Padre Pio, for example, would be in his room sleeping and the devil would come and take him from his legs and throw him off and out of bed. And it's something like that, that's a disturbance. Is the devil now physically being so angry because the person is coming so close to the Lord that he then physically does these attacks. It's called a disturbance. So we have all these six ways that the devil comes to attack us. They are, again, the temptation, infestation, obsession, vexation, possession, and disturbance. But the Lord is our strength. The Lord is our rock. When we put our trust in the Lord, the devil can come with all these things, but we can remain faithful and firm in the Lord. The Lord is the one who gives us salvation, everlasting life. And I would like to mention this before I finish. One of the things that confuse people a lot is that some people go to visit mediums. And unfortunately, even some members of our Catholic Church do this wrongly, do also this. They go out of curiosity. Sometimes they go to see their cards or their palms or their cigarette or something like that. And they practice all these evil things. That is very dangerous. Why? Because the information that they receive comes from the devil, not from the Lord. That's why it is so dangerous. For instance, I remember talking to someone who was saying, "Father, I wanted to sell my house, and I didn't know, I wasn't sure what to do. So I wanted to ask my wife, who is already deceased, to see if that was a good idea for me to do." So he went to see this person who was reading his cards. And the person who was reading the cards was able to describe his wife. The way she was dressed was exactly as she would do that, the way she would talk, physically how she looked, everything. So the medium was able to describe the wife to this man. So he was convinced that he was being, you know, in front of his wife. Then he asked what to do with the house. What he didn't know is that he was not talking to his wife. He was talking to a devil who loves representing and playing like human beings. And we see this remember the passage from Holy Scripture, when the Lord himself is talking to us and he says, there were two men, remember that passage, a man that was so rich and another and Lazarus who was too poor. And the rich man was eating and having banquets every day, and he didn't care about the poor man who had nothing to eat. But at the end, when both of them died, then the rich man found himself in hell. And when he saw Lazarus, the poor man, with Abraham in heaven. And he said to Abraham, "Please let him come to touch the tip of my tongue to refresh, because it's too hot in here." And Abraham says, "No, he can't. There is a great abyss between the two of you. There is no way of communication." And that's what it is. Once, remember how we have both a body and a soul. The way to nurture our soul is through Holy Communion. When we receive Holy Communion, we nurture our soul. That's the only way that we strengthen our soul, through Holy Communion, through the real presence of Jesus Christ in the Holy Eucharist. At the time of death, there is a separation. Our body remains here in a holy place in the cemetery, and the soul goes to have a personal encounter with the Lord right away. There is a personal encounter first, and then eventually we will have the final judgment for everybody. But at the beginning, there is a personal encounter. But once the person goes to have this personal encounter with the Lord, there is no way back. The soul doesn't have the power to come back to earth. There is no power to do. the person remains wherever the Lord put him, either in these three states, either hopefully in heaven or in purgatory, but it's also hell. So those three states are possible for the soul to be located by the Lord at the moment of the personal judgment. But once the person is located there, there is no way for them to come back, for the soul of the person to come back to earth. There is a great abyss, as the Lord says in Holy Scripture. That's why when the mediums are saying, oh yes, I'm talking to your wife, no, that's not your wife in the case that I presented in my example. That's not your wife. She doesn't have the power to come back. What the person is doing is talking to a devil who loves playing the role of a human being. And that's a way for the devil to confuse people and to bring infestation and eventually vexation and a possession. That's why the church says, stay away from it. Just trust in the Lord. The Lord is like a good, responsible, loving Father. That's why we call Him our Heavenly Father. He provides for His children, and we are His children through the sacrament of baptism. So that's why it's important that we just simply rely in divine providence and trust in our Lord. My brothers and sisters, I mentioned this again. I participated in this conference at the beginning of the year in Rome when we were talking about the prayers of liberation and also exorcism. I would like to remind you that we have the exercise holy water and that in your right side of the church. You can take it and bring it home. You can bless your home. You can bless yourself. The holy water that is exercised, not only that it is holy water, it reminds us of the sacrament of baptism, but also by being exercised, it carries with it the prayers of exorcism. And when you sprinkle it in your home, in the places where you work, the prayers of exorcism takes play, and they help to fight against the devil. We are, as all the exorcists were saying in the conference, we are not to be afraid of the devil. We are to be afraid of living a life that is not pleasing in the eyes of the Lord. Living a life with sin. We have to be afraid of sin, but not of the devil. When we are living in a state of grace, the saints say, it is the devil who is afraid of us when we are living in the state of grace. May the Lord help us then to be always closer to the Lord. And one thing that we see in today's gospel that can help us to be close to Christ is when we are humble. The Lord says, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.